r/AskReddit. Serious, Doctor of Reddit. What was the saddest death you have experienced in the hospital? 3-year-old child had been left in care of mom's best friend. He was beaten, burned, and sodomized. He was found in critical condition when friend and her boyfriend called 911 after he fell down the stairs. Irreversible brain damage. Couldn't imagine the pain he went through. He died a few weeks later. Luckily, friend and boyfriend eventually went to trial and were locked up. Tore me up for quite a while. WTF is wrong with people? We had a middle-aged woman come to the ER for a bad headache. She was otherwise healthy. A brain scan showed she had stage 4 brain cancer and an estimated 10-14 days to live. Her judgment and understanding was affected by the tumor, so she didn't understand what was happening. The hardest part was telling her husband that his wife, who was fine the day before, is never leaving the hospital and there's nothing he can do. Wow, this is so heartbreaking. A 33-year-old guy with an IV drug habit relatively hidden from his family. He was sent to the ICU for endocarditis and was starting to improve from septic shock when his wife decided to bring in the kids to visit daddy. Sadly, on the day of their visit, he had a cardiac arrest and we had to usher the family out while we performed CPR. Hearing the crying of a grade school kids in the background of a code is something that will always stick with me. God, I am so sorry. There is nothing I can say to take away those cries, but I can say, you are amazing in the hard, heartbreaking work you do. Please know that it means the world and beyond to the rest of us. Doctor, a few years ago I had a 50-year-old guy on our intensive care unit who had had a cardiac arrest overnight from a pulmonary embolism, but had survived so far. He had had a colon cancer removed 1 week before and had been doing really well afterwards. Walking around the ward, almost ready to go home. Generally healthy guy apart from this. Now after the arrest he was clinging on to life by a thread. I came to review him as part of my normal ward round and his daughter was there with him. Very upset as anyone would be. I chatted to her and examined him, explaining what we were doing for him. She knew things were not looking good. As I was writing my notes in the corner she started just wailing, "Dad, come on Dad, don't leave us now. Please, don't do this. I can't manage without you." I almost lost it completely. It was so sad. I spent a very long time washing my hands in the corner. Shortly afterwards I and my boss went to talk to his family about his prognosis. He was almost certainly going to die. It was his wife, daughters, and 75-year-old mother. I could hardly look his mum in the face as we were talking to them. Old people crying has to be one of the hardest things to see. Normally they are tough as nails. Then the cardiac arrest alarm went off. I looked at them all and ran out of the room. It was him. We couldn't save him. Jesus. I can't even imagine that pain. It scares me so much. I'm so sorry and so in awe that you put yourself through that to help others. I'm in a subject area that could be used to get into treating patients. It scares me how much I would become invested in them. I don't wanna be heartless, but I don't know if I could handle that trauma. I've seen 2 men at a count at this point in my career. Here's one that sticks with me. A mother with a baby at full term was in a bad motor vehicle collision. We did everything in our toolbox to try to save the mother and the baby. CPR, massive blood transfusion, C-section, and more. Neither made it out of the operating room. I remember a similarly awful death of a young mother and baby at near term. She ran over the cord with an electric mower and electrocuted herself. CPR and an emergency C-section in the ED res's room. I was really junior at the time, so was relegated to being a gopher. But the mayhem, mess and smell still lingers. But not as much as the hideous wail of horror and disbelief from the husband when he was told his new family was gone before it had begun. Anesthesia resident in St. Louis, on my pediatric rotation, went down to the ED for a gunshot wound. Arrived to the trauma bay and found a crowd of providers doing chest compressions on a girl who couldn't even be older than 4. She had a very active bleed coming from a bullet wound in her sternum. Intubated, IV access, gave fluids, EP, and after 20 minutes of coding they called it. The collective weight on everyone in the room was palpable. Nobody knew her more than 20 minutes, but goddamn is it sad when an innocent child dies. I used to do psych consults in a huge metropolitan area for different hospitals that were in the same network. All very different demographics and different work cultures. When the extremely rare child death occurred, the entire staff would be shaken for weeks. Like, the grief and guilt was palpable. I can't imagine working in a children's hospital. A nurse here, not a doctor. Anyways, a 24-year-old running a local half marathon or 10K, he told his friend he didn't feel great, collapsed at the finish line, coded and died on arrival to the air. The physician, a stone-cold guy, called the kid's parents to tell them they lived in another state, and he had tears in his eyes. Both the kid's parents were doctors. They asked if we shocked him. Gave him EP. We said we did everything. They declined an autopsy. We assumed he must have had an unknown cardiac myopathy and it finally caught up to him. I still remember his face and his story. Breaks my heart. I work in genetics and we investigate these kinds of deaths. I think about 25% or so of sudden cardiac deaths under 40 are due to an underlying genetic condition. It never gets any easier though, seeing the family and when they realize there may be a risk of it happening again. The good news is several cases we've been able to identify what it going on and people have been cleared, or if they've also been diagnosed they get a defib implanted or treatments to avoid another death. Still one of the hardest things to work with, I think, especially when it's a child. Emergency physician. Most deaths I see aren't immediately sad because the ones that come to me have already died or on the brink of death. There is no time to build any context or relationship with the patient or family, and therefore not easy to experience strong feelings. But one stuck out to me greatly, not because of the actual death but because of what happened afterwards. A 35-year-old unfortunate woman was suffering from metastatic breast cancer to the brain. The tumor was slowly swelling and causing her to start to become altered. She could tell she wasn't thinking or communicating clearly, and it frustrated her and her husband to tears. The other thing was that her cancer was already known to be terminal and her days were numbered. I sat and talked with them about her CT results. Offered to have her watched in the hospital, but we all knew she'd probably be best spending her last days at home with her family. Normally I don't let altered patients go home, but in this case I thought it'd be best. I sort of forgot about her until her husband presented to me as a patient a year later. He told me that I did a great job and that they were grateful for my care, but she died a few weeks after I saw her. She left behind two kids. He gave me a hug that day, and we cried together. First and only time I've ever cried on shift. There are a few that stick with me. I'm gonna try to use layman terms as much as possible, but if anyone wants me to elaborate I can. A 32-year-old woman developed a necrotic bowel, dead guts. We coded her for an hour, because we would continue to regain a heartbeat for a few minutes at a time and the family took that as a good sign. Finally, we get a strong heartbeat, but I felt like the damage had been done. Over the next few days she deteriorated, until one morning I come in and find her pupils are blown. She was absolutely brain dead. She wound up getting pulled from life support that day. On her son's 12th day, a 47-year-old lady with metastatic breast cancer, but no family, and she lived in absolute poverty. Healthcare costs bankrupted her, pretty much. All she had was a house, but no electricity, water or gas to heat the place. She came in one night saying she was really cold and hadn't eaten in a few days. We admitted her, and she died the next day. No family, no friends. The only thing she had with her was a written will leaving everything she owned, her house, to a local church. A gentleman who was a Vietnam War vet came in because he could no longer swallow. He had horrible bone cancer of the jaw, so his left lower jaw had grown to the point where he could no longer close his mouth and his teeth pushed out and into his lips. He had no insurance other than the VA insurance for veterans, and since he wanted to be comfort care they wanted to play games about getting him any kind of long-term IV nutrition. While he was stuck in insurance limbo, we could really only give him pain meds and watch him wither away. He also died alone, and had a small service at the local DAV where some other vets showed up to pay their respects to a fallen brother. RN received a patient maybe a day or two after she came in. Absolute sweetheart on BBP, large amounts of air, who cried when I braided her hair that day because nobody took the time to in the days she has been here. Came back maybe 3 days later, and she was on hospice care. Turns out her oxygen levels dropped super low that night and they were only doing comfort measures. I walked in, and she wasn't that conscious. Her breathing was labored, but I had a comb and our shampoo caps in my hand as I slowly combed out the previous braid I made and made one that hid the bip-bop mask. The family this time was in tears as I talked to her and joked about some stuff we joked about a few days prior. She ended up passing away maybe an hour after that. But I still feel so honored to be with her during those last precious hours of her life. L. One of my longer frequent flyer patients died a few days ago. I'm happy they finally agreed to hospice care, but at the same time I'm definitely going to miss him. Nurse here. I had a patient who knew they had very little time to live, and was working on a letter to their estranged child. When I went in the room to help with after-death care, I found the letter, where they had only written half the first sentence before they passed. They died alone. Nurse in the medical IQ here. I once took care of a 30-year-old breast cancer survivor. The woman had had a son 6 months prior and the cancer came back aggressively. Tests and imaging confirmed the cancer had spread to her lungs, liver, kidneys, and spine. She was treated from the neck down for acute liver failure, sepsis, respiratory failure, and acute kidney disease. She was jaundiced from head to toe, tracheid and vented, required a suprapubic catheter that drained bloody urine, daily dressing changes for her stage 4 tunneling pressure ulcers, her skin weeped serous fluid, required continuous dialysis, IV narcotics to mitigate pain, and had around-the-clock heavy antibiotics and antifungals to treat her ongoing infections. Nearing the end of her life, she required 3 different pressor medications and continuous PRBCs and platelet infusions to maintain her blood levels and blood pressure. After all of these invasive and harsh medical interventions, she was not getting any better. However, she was still mentally stable, was able to answer yes/no questions, and her husband would hold up his phone so she could FaceTime her son nightly. Due to her unrelenting disease, the medical team encouraged the husband to make her comfort care and withdraw interventions to let her pass comfortably. The husband refused to retract her full code status and still hoped she would get better. The night I had her, she required 7 units of blood, 3 platelet infusions, and she was bleeding from every orifice from progressive dick. We had 2 crash carts outside her room ready and a slew of somber nurses ready to code her. Her case was so bleak the doctors enacted a 2 physician code status change to make her comfort care against the husband's wishes to withdraw care. I left at 7:30 that morning and she died at 10 a.m. I wouldn't be able to pick one. The hardest confirmations are ones with big families. In the palliative ward, a grandmother passed away surrounded by her husband, sister, about 6 adult children and their spouses, and many grandchildren. She was about 65 pounds when she passed and had terminal apnea. It's sometimes called a death rattle, where a dying patient is gasping for air. They had to pull her daughter out of the room because she was so distraught. There was nowhere else to fit the entire family, so we ended up in the courtyard. It was raining that day, but none of them cared. The children didn't understand and kept playing. So I ended up taking them to the other end to show them the flowers while the palliative care team talked to the family. The most memorable one was a child with a recurring hematological cancer. She had a great sense of humor and wanted to grow up to be an artist. Charities visit the children's ward and they all knew to give her paintbrushes, sketch pads, etc. because she didn't want toys. The nurses put her many drawings up at the nurses' station. Her parents were really struggling with all the appointments, financial burden, etc. So to my surprise, the mother fell pregnant. They were hoping for an umbilical stem cell transplantation. Cord blood is a significant source of stem cells, which could be used for their daughter's treatment. Their daughter suddenly died of an infection weeks before the mom was due to give birth. That death rattle. I've heard it from my grandfather, died from drinking, my grandmother, dementia and strokes, and lastly, from my own father a few years ago, visited him every day while he was heavily drugged at home, from drinking duck. I'm glad I'm more proactive about my drinking. It's still an issue, but I'm working on it, not ducking my life up. I don't know if it counts. Those were the incidents which led to her patient's death from pneumonia in intensive care a month later. Poor fellow, 70 m, was informed that it would be best to move to a retirement home because of his disabilities, was at the clinic after multiple surgeries for herniated discs, and that he'd probably not be able to care for himself in his apartment. We later found that at first he'd tried to cut his wrists with a razor, not a blade, the cage ones, while he wrote his suicide note. which of course did not work because these things won't cut deep enough, leaving his room in a bloody mess. I was called several hours later at midnight, because he had been found silently moaning in pain beneath a third floor window with severe hypothermia. The patients and nurses who found him initially thought that he had been drinking and that he'd stumbled on the way back inside and then fallen into the garden bed. But after bringing him inside and a look at the severe injuries of his legs, won't go into detail, the worst injuries I have seen in my career, it became clear that he had jumped out of that window legs first. His intention worked out with a gruesome delay, such a sad and unnecessary death, just because he felt that it would mean the complete loss of his autonomy to move into a retirement home. Edit. Interesting. How this got the starting point for a discussion on assisted suicide. This patient could have probably been saved if the information would have been presented to him with a more careful wording and by leaving him more than one option on how to carry on with his life. A nursing service would have been possible as well, in my opinion. It was not my patient. Honestly, stories like this are why I support end-of-life autonomy. When someone is approaching the end of their life, whether by terminal illness, irreversible degenerative cognitive decline, or age, who are we to tell them they must carry on marching into the jaws of a slow, painful, miserable death rather than end their life painlessly on their own terms? There are many completely painless ways to go peacefully at home surrounded by whoever they want present. Who are we to stop them? Whoa, you made it to the end? You're a ducking beast. I'll cut you a deal. Smash like and subscribe for more curated content, mate. It's free and that's a great price.